The following program is from NET, the National Educational Television Network.
We find it hard, America. We don't get much news from there, just scattered stories. Brazil elected a new beauty queen. They have trouble with their money. They had some sort of revolution. There's nothing to give any continuing sense of real people leading real lives. Also, we are ignorant as children. Try these facts. South of us, there is a nation larger than the United States, if you don't count Alaska and Hawaii. They speak Portuguese, not Spanish. About half the population of South America belong to Brazil. Also, many problems. In the north, tropical jungle, drought, poverty, overpopulation. Down south, wealth and industry. In the middle, emptiness. And yet, out of all of this, there is emerging an underdeveloped nation at the point of takeoff in its development, where the struggle begins toward progress without external assistance. Brazil certainly has a long, hard way to go. The level of income and the standard of life among the poor in its backward northeast are as low as anything that can be found in our hemisphere. Their misery is morally disturbing and politically dangerous. For a time, the voice of the communist rang louder and louder there, and his hand was raised to inhibit United States efforts to bring help to these troubled people. Brazil's money has long been a mockery. It was hard to see how they were losing 80% of its value in 1 year. As this happened, it seemed some kind of crack-up must be at hand. There were no coins anymore, just great wads of paper bills. To buy one U.S. dollar took 800 cruzeiros, 900, 1,000, 1,500, up and up, skyrocketing to disaster. Investment slowed down, halted. Brazil's then president, Jean Goulart, appeared cool to the United States, warm to communist nations. There was uneasiness in the land. There were incidents of violence, people protesting against the state of affairs, protesting against the things the government had not done, the things it might do. No one was sure of Goulart's intentions. Many said he had no policy, but was merely an opportunist. Many feared he would try to increase the power of the presidency. He was wooing the enlisted men of the armed forces. The time seemed ripe for political upheaval, perhaps for suppression of liberty. And then, in March 1964, political upheaval did come. First one Brazilian state, and then portions of the army announced they would no longer be ruled by the government of Goulart. The president declared he would put down this rebellion. There were movements of troops. No shots were fired, but civil war seemed to be coming. And then the tension was lifted. The armed forces had all moved to the side of revolution. Goulart had fled the country. Some state governors were deposed. Many people, avowed communists and others, were put in jail. There had been no resistance, no bloodshed. The Congress elected a general, Humberto Castelo Branco, as president. The new government promised sweeping reforms. They said glorious times were coming. In Brazil, there was rejoicing. The United States Department of State manifested deep satisfaction over the change. But where exactly did the revolution take Brazil? United States Ambassador Lincoln Gordon was on the scene. Did the revolution solve any problems?
Well, the revolution really was something which averted a disaster and created new opportunities. It in itself, of course, provided no solutions. Now, the problems that the government inherited after the revolution are enormous, were enormous. There were some short-term problems which were a direct inheritance of the previous, or the chaotic situation. Maladministration, corruption, a rate of inflation which reached 120% a year during the early months of 1964, problems of that kind. And on top of those were all longer-range problems, which problems arising from the rapid population increase, the need for modernization in agriculture, which in general is a very low productivity in Brazil, very, very backward, especially in the northern part of the country. The needs for the buildings of road and power, needs for modernization of education, needs for health, needs for growth and improvement in all respects. Longer run problems. These two put on top of each other in a climate which politically is still, I wouldn't say tense, but a complex one, leave a great deal to be done.
There is so much to be done that it is difficult to calculate how far Brazil has come along the road to self-sufficiency. Brazil still ranks as an underdeveloped nation, which is another way of saying one that depends on other nations for its well-being. The standard way to stay underdeveloped is to let your economy remain one of the gathering and exporting of raw materials. In that way, it is guaranteed that you will be forever at the mercy of the international markets, and guaranteed that no matter how many good times there are, booms will always be followed by busts. And the men who yesterday were busy loading coffee, or sugar, or bananas, or hides, or minerals, will tomorrow be standing around idle, waiting for conditions to improve. The depressed northeast area of Brazil is a sad monument to plantation economies of the past. In the 16th century, this region was the most prosperous one in the land. Brazil was a Portuguese colony then, and had what amounted to a world monopoly on sugar. There was a boom which lasted for 100 years. There were large plantations served by large populations of slaves brought in from Africa. Then sugar production elsewhere started up, and the boom was followed by a bust. Now there are too many people for the income of the land. There is an aching poverty. As in the colonial days, a few people monopolize large holdings of land. Sugar production limps along. Slavery was abolished in 1888. Just over half a century after Brazil had gained independence as a nation. But many people of the Northeast might as well be slaves so far as the conditions of their life are concerned. Hunger hovers behind, along with disease. Illiteracy is the rule. Before the revolution, the communists attracted the greatest notice here by protesting against this misery. Now that they have been silenced, the voice of the church emerges, putting pressure on the government and pressure on the big landowners for economic and social reforms. The landowners wait to see what the government may do, and the misery remains, shouting for change. Change will likely come, for these people are determined to climb. They no longer accept oppression as an inescapable fact of life, like rain or the blistering sun. The cowboys who ride the wide ranges of the northeastern backlands are traditionally men of spirit. Old men among them remember times when they rebelled and the government had to call in the army to put them down. It was not clear what they were rebelling against, except that it had something to do with the townspeople having all the money and the cowboy having no money. No land, nothing. They glare at money as if it were an enemy. And well they might, for as matters stand right now, money is just that. Consider those wads of bills. What are they worth? Less today than they were last month, next month likely less than now. So if you have money, the best thing to do is get rid of it as fast as you can. Not in a bank with inflation cutting into it all the time. No, you have to buy something. And one of the best ways to salt away your money is to buy land. This creates another category of land shortage. For just as there are people in some areas of Brazil who are cursed with land hunger because the land is overcrowded, so there are people in other areas kept hungry because the land is kept empty. In northeastern Brazil, a new kind of attack on the land problem is being mounted. Groups of peasants are helped by United States advisors to form agricultural cooperatives. They learn how each farmer can be an independent owner but can share the help or the tools of the rest where this is more useful. The United States is offering Latin America many kinds of help under the aid program called the Alliance for Progress. Some of this help is financial, but the main idea is that Latin countries should do most of the work and that aid should serve as pump primer, helping to stimulate reforms. Some charge that our efforts produce no reforms, that in consequence our building houses, schools, hospitals, or roads, are feeding the hungry, are doing any of the beneficial things that are done under the alliance, really amounts to doing things these countries might better do for themselves. In short, that aid brings no change. In Brazil, the United States has selected the Northeast as prime target for assistance. As symbol and example, it would seem that helping peasants to stand up for themselves and farm their own land does constitute taking a shot at social change. With so much to be done, individual efforts tend to look small and unavailing. Geraldo Daneman is a banker in the northeastern state of Bahia. What measures work to start an economy changing?
Well, once you can create a stimulus for industrial activity to take place in the area, there's one thing that industry can find, and it's raw materials. Another economic factor is the human resource. It has to be trained, but it is found there. Once you start using those human resources, what happens? The per capita income is going to go up. Therefore, purchasing power is going to go up, and that is an additional attraction for industry.
How do you start this interaction of human and material resources? Maurice Osimo has an answer. He's a professor of engineering at UCLA, and taking a team from there and from the University of Ceará in northeast Brazil, he went into the backlands of that state to study what the area had in resources and what its needs were. Then he took his plans to local citizens and asked for money, $1 million worth of money in the impoverished Northeast. Their first reaction was astonishment, but before Osimo was done, the community had scraped up the money in exchange for stock in five companies. The five began to grow, each useful in a particular way. A radio plant, for example, was a good idea because the radio is a vital source of information and entertainment in the far country. The thing to bear in mind is that these are all legitimate businesses with Brazilian boards of directors financed by local investment. Like many new enterprises, the radio plant had to take on new workers and train them. The assembly line is now turning out sets faster than the cabinet department can build cases. People who work in the plants, ranging from trained engineers who have come home from the cities to young apprentices, have all got a spiritual investment that can't be matched with money. This, on a small scale, is the way the Alliance for Progress is supposed to work. ¶¶ Projects like this are springing up all over Latin America, and observers are coming to Serrat to profit by Asimov's example. And knowledge is the real currency here. By the time this corn processing plant is completed, all of the original five making food, radios, shoes, ceramics, and wood products will be operating. Local people are already raising money for two more. It looks like a small-scale industrial revolution, but there is one thing. This is a backward area, and the question remains how far such industrial development can go if it is not supported by a matching agricultural revolution. Roberto Campos is Brazil's new minister of planning. Will the government expropriate land, taking it away from large holders?
Oh, yes, that would be necessary, certainly, in some of the areas in which there is pressure on land, and in which there is a great degree of, a high degree of social bitterness, so that expropriation and redistribution will become necessary. Fortunately, in the Brazilian case, those are rather limited areas, four or five areas throughout the country. For the majority of the country, what one needs is a good agrarian policy and a good tax system that would encourage the productive use of land and encourage voluntary redistribution of land to escape the tax burden. Expropriation will be a limited remedy for certain areas, but it will certainly be necessary and it will certainly be done. We are thinking really of three different instruments of agrarian reform adapted to regional conditions. First, a progressive land taxation. This would be applied universally throughout Brazil. Secondly, expropriation in certain critical areas. And thirdly, colonization to occupy vast tracts of land which are still unoccupied.
Brazil contains ample space for colonization. There are areas like the Amazon that are next to being deserted. But the government will have to be very firm against powerful resistance. They will also have to induce people to settle places where few have chosen to go. The Amazon Valley contains about 45% of the total land area of Brazil, and less than 5% of the people live there. Within certain limits, life can be easy. There is swampy jungle, but also lots of high ground. The economy is stagnant, but the individual settler can always find a market for his jute, or palm oils, or Brazil nuts, or wood. It's never difficult to induce anything to grow, so one need not be hungry. On the other hand, the range of diet is limited, so one is seldom properly nourished. The death toll of many tropical ailments has been reduced, but others remain. Disease is mysterious, a thing to be tolerated. Life is cheap. There is every possibility that this area, along with many others in Brazil, might be more heavily settled. But there is great inertia, an attitude of listless submission, of taking out what the land grants without putting anything in. Tools are primitive, methods are archaic. Partly, the difficulty may come from things being so ready to hand. Basically, all you have to do is cut into a rubber tree, the rubber drips out, and you can catch it and sell it. Riches waiting to be picked up. So at the end of the 19th century, there was a rush to the Amazon rubber forests like the Alaska Gold Rush. But then the bubble burst, and the flow of rubber from the Amazon dropped to a trickle. There was a blight that hit the trees. Someone planted rubber trees in the Far East. Prices dropped. The prospectors left. The trickle went on, and there it stays today, not even supplying a fraction of Brazil's needs. The story of Amazonian rubber is a classic because it matches the pattern of so many other Brazilian booms. The sugar boom, the cocoa boom, the diamond boom, the gold boom, the coffee boom. Each of them brought something to the country that stayed. But that something never seemed to be quite enough, perhaps because the boom itself was founded on the notion of taking what was there without giving much back. Each of the boom and bust products has had to be rediscovered and started up again on a different basis. There is symbolic irony in the fact that the most promising research on how to lick the rubber tree blight is being done by a private American company in the Brazilian state of Bahia, a couple of thousand miles from the Amazonian rubber forests. In the Amazon, the trickle goes on, and the land waits for development. And life itself goes on. The waterfront at Manaus contains a whole trading city floating on logs. This is as things should be, for the waterways are the main arteries of the region. Remote settlers bring in their bananas or jute or alligator skins or whatever and trade it for canned goods, salt, kerosene, other things they need. Usually they are in debt to the trader. The trader gives them credit, and he himself gets credit from larger exporting firms. This is all right. Brazil floats on debts. Vultures vie with the hogs at picking over the garbage. The vulture as a street cleaner is a respected bird in Brazil. The life of the floating city at Manaus has that same air of permanent impermanence that often seems to pervade the country at large. Things were better once. Perhaps they will improve again. In the meantime, one finds a way. One gets on. One is a stoic. In the upper city, the part that is based on dry land, there is a stronger echo of past glories, of the faded graces belonging to another time, another people. And towering above it all, a monument to the tradition of boom and bust, an opera house that might match any in Europe, where whole companies were brought in from Milan to Manaus to sing Verdi before the rubber barons, who sent their dress shirts to Portugal to be laundered. In the plaza before the opera house, a new generation plays soccer. Their vibrant energy does not quite silence melancholy echoes of the past, past triumphs, past mistakes. What can the future do for them? What can they do for the future? Reynold E. Carlson, an economist and a representative of the Ford Foundation in Brazil, links education and taxation.
The two things that really helped to get the U.S. off the ground were general education at the primary school level, common education for the rank and for every man, Tom, Dick, and Harry, and as early as 1913, the income tax. These two, and property taxes. So let's say education and taxation. Taxation to pare down these individuals who have too much, shall we say, and are using it not in the common, the public, the government's interest, and also the education. Both of these prevail in Brazil. We have a very high income tax, if you read the law, equal almost to the states, but nobody pays income tax. Brazil is, the government does not have the necessary tax revenue, so it must resort to inflation. So one important reform, apart from this land business, is in taxation. Taxation of land is practically nil. Therefore, anybody can sit on a piece of land forever and doesn't have to worry about paying taxes. Now, in the States, property taxes are very high. And you cannot sit on a piece of land very long but without losing a considerable amount of money.
And you think that taxation in itself would work obliquely to increase individual opportunity?
In several ways, in the land alone. If there were a genuine or real property tax, much of this agrarian reform problem would just disappear. Because you cannot sit on a huge estate if the property taxes are high. The taxes compel, with generation after generation, a breaking up of the land, setting off a piece here to pay the death taxes, setting off a little piece here to pay the property taxes. This has been the history of states, not so here. Second item, let me just mention it, is education. Education in Brazil is like an hourglass, you know, that sort of thing. The bottom piece of the hourglass is the primary education, which is free. The top piece of the hourglass is university education, which is free. But the STEM is secondary education, which is not free. You have to pay tuition. 3/4 of the kids in Brazil have to pay tuition to go to high school. Now, with the income level that Brazil has, most of the kids never have a chance to go to high school. Therefore, their opportunities are cut off at this stem in our hourglass. There are a few public high schools, government high schools, but nothing to meet the needs of the country.
These children vaulting into the future are lucky. They are city dwellers, members of the expanding middle class. Their parents can pay for their education. They can pass through the stem of the hourglass and get a university degree, a job of the sort they want, for they are members of an elite. About 50% of the Brazilian people are illiterate. Just about that same percentage of children today are not attending school. The population is now over 70 million. It is estimated that in another generation, this figure will double. Consider a nation of 70 million people, which has been able to teach only half its citizens how to read and write, has a birth rate that will put its population up to 140 million in another 25 years. The family is a very strong unit in Brazil, but this population explosion is bound to put heavy strains on that and other spiritual values of the people. Brazil is a deeply religious country. It has been called the most Catholic nation of our times. The reach of the church is so extensive that its touch is soft, and yet its influence is pervasive. Is a mass being celebrated in Bahia, which has the highest concentration of people with Negro blood. Were the church in São Paulo or further south in Porto Alegre, there most of the faces would be white, but the atmosphere would be the same. There is every possibility that Brazil may become a model to the rest of the world of people of different colors and different roots getting on. For they do mix and they do get on, and it is part of their sense of national self to do so. This is not to say that Negroes are not disadvantaged. They are. They began as slaves. They have further to come. Most of them start low in economic advantage, in schooling, in the chance of social mobility. There's an old Brazilian saying, the darker the skin, the lower the class. The lighter the skin, the higher the class. But there are other sayings. Money whitens the skin. Also, people say, there is no racial discrimination, only social discrimination, which means, among other things, that there is a greater gap between middle class and poor than any gap of color. Partly, this social easiness may come from the gentle teachings of the church. Partly, it may come from the fact that the first Portuguese settlers were easy in the matter of race and interbred in a way that produced society having many shades of color. One thing is certain. If the nation is to prosper, people of all races and colors will be needed. And being needed is a great advantage. Considering the mixture of people making up Brazil, Portuguese settler stock, Indians, Negroes, Germans, Italians, Poles, Japanese, and more, one might wonder that any connecting national consciousness exists. Yet there is one, and it is very strong. With minor exceptions, Portuguese is the language spoken from one corner of the country to another. There is a patriotism, as seen in this independence celebration in Bahia, which appears to help the people weather social and political difficulty. In 1822, Brazil passed from being a colony to being a constitutional monarchy without any war for independence from Portugal. In 1889, the monarchy became a republic in name and an oligarchy in practice, again without any battles. In 1930, under Getúlio Vargas, the nation became a dictatorship. In 1946, it became a democracy. Politically, this sounds like a turbulent mixture indeed. And yet, all these changes have been made with little or no bloodshed. The country appears to have an enormous power to go peaceably on adapting to new conditions. It is fortunate if this be so, for changes of a sort to put great strain on the temper and habits of some sectors of the community appear to be necessary if the revolution is to have any meaning. Inflation may be only a symptom of deeper troubles, but it stands at the core of national life. In a nation which does not enforce its tax laws, the easiest way to pay the bills is to print more money. Once the government thinks that way, everyone has to think that way, if they are to go on eating. So all of life becomes a marketplace where everyone is trying to sell something with one hand and manipulate credit with the other. Money's going to be worth less next month, it pays to buy on credit. If enough people buy on credit, the money has got to be worth less next month. In the end, it is to the interest of many people to keep the currency deteriorating. How is this to be brought to a halt? Will the poor themselves, as well as the rich, have to tighten their belts? Economist Ronald Carlson.
Well, it's going to have to be divorced, probably. The real burden of the last 10 years has fallen upon the middle and lower income people. Inflation makes the rich richer and the poor poorer. It's a kind of taxation on the wage earner. Because he lives with a wage fixed for a single year, and meanwhile the cost of living rises like this. Meanwhile prices rise. This means the industrial sector is defending itself beautifully against inflation. They can raise prices like this. But the poor guy on the payroll, he's sitting there until his union gives him an increase. So, if something could be done to arrest the inflation rate, then we'll get a distribution of income, which is now cockeyed, right, in favor of certain industrial groups because of their position, and will be put it back more towards an equilibrium level. These poor guys down the line, the middle and lower income groups, will not have half of their income taken away from them by inflation.
In the southern part of Brazil, there stands a city which seems to belong to a different world from the softer, slower cities of the north. It is São Paulo. São Paulo is as dynamic as Chicago. It reaches for the sky like New York. In 1875, this city had a population of 25,000 people. Today, its population is in the neighborhood of 5 million. Its birth as a huge metropolis was founded on efficient farming, which led to surplus capital, which was invested in industry. It is the southern part of Brazil which has drawn the European immigrant, bringing his industrial skills and his sense of what is a proper standard of living. This sounds like progress, until one reflects that Brazil is inveterately backward in agricultural methods and has to go on importing food, and until one reflects that São Paulo itself was founded on a sound agriculture that produced not deficit, but surplus. It is not disparaging São Paulo's growth to consider that for this to continue, the rest of the nation may have to be helped to catch up. Industrialization was speeded by the dictator Vargas, who resolved to turn Brazil into a nation which could manufacture the consumer goods it needed. The depression of the 30s and the war added impetus by impeding trade, and subsequent leaders have seconded the nationalist notion that most of the ingredients of life should bear the label made in Brazil. Paradoxically, it was only possible to do this by means of foreign investment, since Brazilian surplus capital was insufficient, and this has always been something of a sore point. Goulart had caused foreign investment almost completely to dry up. Now the new revolutionary government has opened the door again, taking steps to attract capital almost without regulation.
If you put capital, enterprise, money, know-how, etc., in the Northeast.
Hermano Alves, political editor of a paper which criticizes the new government, takes a nationalist viewpoint, demanding that foreign capital be controlled.
And so, just like Italy, when you invest money in the south of Italy, you have more advantage than investing money in the north of Italy. And so we want the control of our development. We don't want our development to be controlled by the interests of private enterprise, of foreign private enterprise. If we are trying to control the development and the actions of the Brazilian foreign and Brazilian enterprise, why can't we control the activities of foreign investment? That's our point of view, our opinion. And when an American or a European enterprise comes in conflict of interest with a state enterprise or a Brazilian enterprise, and so we say we must give support to our national enterprise, even if private or state enterprise. That's our opinion, our frank opinion.
The whole humanity is confronted with two alternatives only. We can choose to live according to Christian moral and the Western way of living, or we can choose to live under complete controlled government.
Paulo Iris, a São Paulo industrialist, takes the view of an internationalist.
To other countries. I believe very strongly that the whole people in this side of the world still prefers freedom, liberty, and still values the Christian morals Christian moral principles as the principles to live for, to fight for. So I think that the only thing we can do is to prove to the whole world that our conception of life is better. And we can only do that by learning that from now on we're living a new reality, a reality which imposes to all of us the duty to work for the things we have been preaching. And we have been preaching for one world. And so we must start by building one continent, one group of peaceful, progressive countries living together, because they think not only along the same lines, they share the same ideals, but they really work for a much broader economy. I mean, nobody will be thinking about company problems or country's problems, but continental problems. This would be a good start for all of us.
One of the things that irritates Brazilians about American investment is that there's so much of it. It's difficult to be international-minded if you have the feeling that you're not master of your own fate. In the state of São Paulo alone, there are about $500 million invested. Some companies are totally managed and run from home, with a responsibility only to U.S. investors. Other companies, like the Willys plant in São Paulo, are capitalized in Brazil, run by Brazilians. This latter sort is more popular locally. However companies may be organized, Brazilian industry is impressive both for weight and diversity, also for the speed with which things get done. The whole automobile industry is about 7 years old. 7 years ago, these men did not have these skills. Nobody did. Foreign investment in Brazil has often relieved that nation of the task of evolving this or that industry. Skills and devices which may represent years of costly research and development elsewhere have been brought straight in and put to work. This company manufactures 5,000 vehicles a month, for that is the number it can sell domestically. The factory is geared to produce another 2,000. It has a vital interest in seeing the general standard of life in the nation improved, and so do all the other millions of people involved in the industrial boom of southern Brazil. The revolution that tossed out Goulart and set up a cry for economic and social reform had some of its strongest backing in the South. Factory workers, like industrialists, wanted to see production continue. They wanted to see it expand. They saw Goulart's confused administration as a menace to this. What remains to be seen is how far the South will be able to perceive the deeper confusions and inequities that cry for change. Will they realize that their own welfare is linked to that of less fortunate people in their own nation? It is hard to say. The industrial explosion of the South has acquired great impetus. Grant them the best will in the world. Have there been enough changes in social structure there to carry the rest of the country forward? American Ambassador Lincoln Gordon.
Oh, indeed. Indeed. It has changed enormously. You have only to visit a city like São Paulo, which is a city of now almost 5 million people, with very modern industry. You have only to see smaller cities like Belo Horizonte, Porto Alegre in the far south, Curitiba, Even Recife, with all of the difficulties that exist in the Northeast, and you see in the urban side, and not so much yet in the rural side, but on the urban side, you see a process of very rapid modernization taking place, the development of a true middle class. In fact, it was this true middle class which was largely responsible for the revolution of late March 1964. Brazil is very much a country in motion, and the notion that it has a distant future before it, but something that will never be realized, I think is an entirely mistaken notion.
The highways around São Paulo match the pace and stature of the city. But to put São Paulo into perspective, to grasp how industrialization relates to the rest of the country, all one has to do is proceed far enough from the city on any road. The further you get from the metropolis, the more the roads deteriorate. Roads in general may well serve as collective symbol for one of the gravest ailments of the nation, failure of communication. This operates on many levels. On a very basic social level, it appears impossible for town to communicate with country. The middle class revolution that put in a government dedicated to reform was rooted in the towns. But some of the sharpest needs are rooted in the country. Town and country view each other with suspicion. Gauchos in the frontier cattle region of Rio Grande do Sul will look at an outsider the way an old-fashioned Texan might look at a Yankee. Naturally, the poor states hate the rich states. The people of Ceará or Pernambuco, who have to buy tools or farm equipment from São Paulo, scream that they're being made to pay for superhighways down south when they can't even afford to improve their own dirt roads. Behind the famous Brazilian amiability, there stands a cynicism about human nature that works to block change. They do not expect too much of the other fellow. It makes it easier to get on with him, but harder to help him. There are many people who need help, most particularly in the rural areas. These gauchos stand to gain if agricultural efficiency is improved, and their gain is bound to be the nation's gain. There are men at the center who see these things, who see what ought to be done. But to spread the word, to turn knowledge into action, is very difficult. José Arthur Rios, professor of sociology at the Catholic University of Rio de Janeiro. Is perhaps land reform the key to progress?
In Brazil, I think so. I think it is the first step to a very solid process of industrialization, a continuous process of industrial growth. Industrialization in Brazil is closely connected with agrarian reform. In other words, if you don't have a good distribution of land, you won't have an internal market. You won't have high levels of consumption, which will allow for a good, solid, continuous process of industrialization. If an agrarian reform is not done in Brazil, we might have industrialization, but dealing with luxurious products and aiming at the wealth of a few people.
Well, that wouldn't be total industrialization, that's the word that you've been using, would it be?
That's right, but that's the kind of industrialization in oligarchic countries, in countries which are marked by an oligarchic structure. If we want to have a democratic structure in Brazil, we have to change our agrarian structure and to allow for a larger amount of consumers and the raising of the levels of living of the rural population. In the rural population is the future of our industrial market.
In the meantime, these telephone lines, torn down by peasants angry over their inability to communicate their needs, hang idle, waiting for someone to take the bold steps that are needed. Brazilians do not lack in boldness. For a long time, the empty center of the land has stood as a nagging reminder of the nation's inability to pull itself together and realize its potential. In the 1950s, the government, under President Juscelino Kubitschek, decided to put long-term plans into effect and move the capital of the nation into the middle of the country. The result? Brasilia. Arguments raged about this move and will no doubt continue. It was called senseless extravagance, insane egotism, impractical. Moderates said that the move might be a good one, but the time was not right. It was too soon. But the men behind Brasilia pushed it through, and the official capital of the nation was moved there. They claimed it fulfilled a spiritual need of the people. Certainly, the place does seem like an aggressive step into the future. There are almost no private dwellings. Congressmen and government employees live in graceful blocks of reinforced concrete apartments grouped into communities. There are supposed to be no crossroads in Brasilia, and areas where one might walk are grouped. Each nest of apartment blocks has its own schools, its own shops. For the rest, it is expected that one will move in automobiles or by buses. And the city continues to grow. It seems a long way away from the dusty, bureaucratic corridors of the old capital, Rio de Janeiro. Brasilia may well come to serve as capital in the same way that Washington, D.C. stands as spiritual center for Americans. Certainly a great many people come to look it over, just as they do to inspect our capital. And there's no arguing with the proposition that Brazilians need everything they can get to pull them together, to give them a feeling of a new start. Congressmen who roll up to the assembly halls in their limousines are coming to meet an unprecedented challenge. Them members of the educated elite, for the 50% of the Brazilian people who are illiterate have no vote and are not directly represented. The congressmen are most of them comfortably off, many of them fond of the old ways. Many of them have interests or stand close to men who have interests that will be directly harmed by any program of reform. And yet, they are all called to discuss such revolutionary steps as collecting taxes, redistributing land, restricting credit, getting rich states to help poor ones, building thousands of low-cost houses, thousands of schools, more colleges, more hospitals, more roads, more everything that is needed, and curbing inflation to boot. President Castelo Branco has asked a lot of these men. It has been strongly implied that if the Congress does not act, if they delay reform by debate, the army will feel it necessary to step in again. The challenge has been clearly drawn. By reason of its size alone, Brazil is the most influential nation in Latin America. If Brazil fails to prosper, the ideals and interests of the whole hemisphere will be put in danger. But if the general condition of the people is improved, Brazil will prosper. There is very little vocal opposition to the reform programs of the new government. The strongest thing said against them is that they are trying to do what the United States wants them to do. Does this charge make any sense, Minister of Planning Roberto Campos?
I think this charge is extremely unfair. The government is pursuing the course that it thinks best for the development of Brazil. For instance, correcting inflation is not certainly an act of submission either to the dictates of the International Monetary Fund or of the U.S. government or European governments. It results from the fact that inflation last year attained the rate of 80%, which means that at the end of the year, the salaries were 20% of what they were at the beginning. Now, no economy can survive such a dismal situation. So we are correcting inflation. We are seeking to reactivate the inflow of foreign investment, not because we particularly love foreign investment, but because we do not have enough savings, and we want to supplement our savings with the importation of foreign capital.
What will happen to Brazil if these steps are taken? Reynold Carlson.
Brazil is, by definition, not a poor country. It has resources. And in development of these resources, it will achieve a standard of living. Well, in 10 years, Brazil ought to be equal to Italy. In 25 years, Brazil ought to be equal to France, in terms of its resources, its level of living, and especially its position in world affairs.
Brazil has great prosperity and world leadership within its grasp. Like many Latin American countries, its worst enemy is its own past. Unlike some, its best friend is its own future, if the men of power in Brazil can unite in seeing what that future should be.
National Educational Television Network.